Organized with Times Hangout. My name is Avik Das and I will be moderating this session for the next 1 hour. The topic for today's discussion is attracting the talent that stays. In today's uncertain world, there is an immediate need to create a highly engaged workplace, and leaders are finding new ways to showcase their company culture in hopes of attracting potential job candidates and keeping up and talented employees on their staff roles. We have two esteemed panelists to discuss this topic. We have Vikas Dua, an accomplished HR expert with over almost 18 years of experience in the recruitment field, having worked with both startups and large corporations like Wipro and Concentrix, driving hiring in the APAC region. Vikas is also the advisor to the BRICS Chamber of Commerce and Industry and member of the Industry Council at FWA, where he is working towards supporting the student and young professionals community in their learning and entrepreneurship objectives. Welcome, Vikas, on the panel.
Pleasure being here. Thanks, Avik.
Great. We also have Dr. Soumya Badgayan as the other panelist. Now, she has almost 2 decades of corporate experience in the field of sales, marketing, corporate strategy, and HR, with complete knowledge about all the segments of the various markets in the field of luxury products, jewelry, sales, human behavior, and their countless interplays and ramifications. Soumya has been leading the human resource strategist functions for employee business unit, including the training and onboarding, performance management, retention and development and benefits. A warm welcome to you, Soumya, as well.
Thank you so much.
Great to have both of you on the panel. I would now request to have the slides for Vikas up, please, so that he can make the presentation. There you go, Vikas.
Great. Thank you so much for those kind words, Avik. And it is indeed an honor to be part of this program and to share my thoughts with the community on attracting the talent that stays. And I'm sure all of you watching must be pretty intrigued with the photo which you see on the screen up there, a very pretty looking image. But before I throw some light on it, I thought I'd just give a little context why it's up there. See, I spent about 18 years, as Avik pointed out, makes me feel very old, but it has been good 18 years in the IT space, recruiting talent from across the country, and in fact, sometimes internationally as well. And for those of you who are familiar with the BPO space, one thing you have to, and I'm sure you must be aware of, is that it's a space where attritions are crazy. I mean, in the best of years, I've seen us operating at about 40%, 45% annualized attrition, which means that you are replacing half your organization every year. And to that extent, I think somewhere I can call myself at least knowledgeable, if not an expert, on this particular topic of attracting talent and enabling them to stay with an organization, which in our case was a very surprising, substantial period of just 1 year. So that's the landscape I have operated in. And the biggest learning that I've had in these 18 odd years is that the whole process of hiring and bringing someone into an organization and expecting him or her to stay is not very different from the process we go through in our, you know, the whole process of marriage. So your candidate sourcing is really the partner selection stage, where some of us, you know, get the help of Shaadi.com or Varmanti is good and kind enough to help out. Then you have the tests and assessments which happen in the side, which is really the courtship stage in a personal relationship. And many of us, I'm sure, including me, have a cafe coffee day to thank for that. The onboarding, of course, is the nothing but the wedding ceremony, the formal ceremony where the pandit does all his shlokas and brings you into the family. Of course, in the corporate space, it's more of filling up a lot of endless forms and making sure that you take that nice bouquet of flowers they give you home. And finally, at the core of it, what I do feel the similarity between the two is so intense that there is that whole expectation of longevity or permanence that we want, right? Just like our dear friend, Mr. Donald Trump today, who's refusing to let the situation turn. So given that, no one enters a marriage thinking that, oh, this is just 2 years, chal gaya to achha hoga. And it's similarly in the case of hiring as a recruiter, or even as an employee, one always wants that whole engagement to continue for long. And that's the whole problem that all of us, whether in the organization or as a candidate, are hoping to solve. So I have some thoughts around that, which I'll bring forth. And if you can move to the next slide, that would be very helpful. Great. So the whole thought is that it's not really just employer branding, which can be one simple answer to attracting talent that stays. Because the whole idea is to not only attract talent, but also to retain them. So it's attraction and retention that you've got to look at jointly. And my experience says that there are really three pillars that you need to work on. The first pillar is what I call the core values pillar. The second is communication. And third is, of course, the commitment. Now, in any good structure, your civil engineers will tell you that try and make them in parallel so that your efficiencies are high and you end up building the structure in the limited amount of time that you have. You could start with one, then go to two, then go to three, but that will not be optimal. Secondly, also keep in mind, again, a civil engineer will tell you that build those structure or build those pillars of the same height, same dimension, so that the structure is stable. Don't try to build one of a different material, one of a different height. So ultimately, that will not give you the results that you're looking forward to. And in a similar manner, I would say that these pillars kind of go hand in hand. One can't be considered better or less important than the other. When it comes to core values, keep in mind that it's really what your organization stands for. What are the values that you really want to live and drive? And many a time, what many organizations try to do nowadays, especially, is that they want to be everything for everyone, but it doesn't work. Right? Way back in my college, taking that same analogy forward, I somewhere came across a magazine, I don't know, Femina or something, I don't know if it even exists today. But it said that, you know, women like humor in men as the number one driver of attractiveness. So I tried to be very funny and bring that humor element. It did work, honestly, to the level I would have wanted it to. In fact, nowhere close to our good friend Veer Das, VD, who happens to share the same initials as I do. But having said that, you must understand what is the target market wants, or what are the values that the entire economy market is shaping, and see if those are in cultural alignment with you, and then pick those through. You can't fake it, because the fact of the matter is today's kids, Gen Z as we call them, are way too smart. What is happening in your organization, what is happening outside, they can carry and match all the parameters. So make sure that those core values are strong and you're able to actually validate those. The second pillar, which is communication, is really, again, very important. There's no good having a whole set of attributes, qualities, which you can't really display or showcase, right? You could be the strongest guy in the room, but what good is it if you're not fighting for your college or your institute or your country or in the Olympics, right? So you've got to make sure that you make it count. In the college scenario, again, going back to the whole analogy, you maybe had a crush, but you were feeling afraid to kind of go up and admit that you were in love. And meanwhile, you notice that the neighborhood guy managed to take the lead and she was off zooming on the bike and you were left high and dry, in spite of your best friend telling you time and again that go bite the bullet, tell her. And that's pretty much the scenario in the corporate world. You can be the best today, but the world is such, we world moved to a connected social world, that you've got to declare it time and time and time again. It's like, you know, Kareena Kapoor says, "Main apni favorite hoon." So if you don't believe in that and you don't declare that, no one else is really waiting around to wait for you to say it. So be proactive and communicate. The third pillar is commitment. Now, again, keep in mind that you've got to be committed to the values that you hold. You can't have one face internally saying that and driving performance, which is very harsh, which is very brutal. And at the same time, expect that in the market that the face you present is very compassionate, very empowering, bringing in people of different backgrounds together in a very harmonious way. Because these two things will not gel. Understand that today our walls, our office walls, are porous. Everyone has a mobile phone connected to the internet. A small incident that happens within the office is available at the click of a button to anyone across the globe. So if you don't live by those values, the core values, you are not going to be able to build the entire thread together of your entire positioning. And that's really what I say in a nutshell, is making sure that you're not only attracting the talent, but also taking steps to retain the talent, to complete the whole cycle. And you can move on to the last slide, just for reference perspective. This is nothing else but a brief view of my social handles, where HR in my heart is what I normally blog and write under, and you're free to, you know, look me up there. But that's really the simple message that I wanted to share today, is that look at attracting talent in a very holistic way. So it can't be a piecemeal approach of TA folks or recruitment folks looking at just hiring and getting the body into the shop. It has to be an approach of, I want someone who will go the distance with me. So over to you, Avik. I hope that gives some background.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you, Vikas. That's actually a great start. Just one question here. You talked about attrition rates in BPO companies being sometimes as high as 45%. That's nothing new. Now, how do I marry those two views? Like in an industry where attrition is as high as more than 40%, at the same time, you know, if you have to, the concept of growing in an organization, how do you actually gel these two things together?
So a great question, Avik, and I think that's the entire problem that HR fraternity has in the industry has been trying to solve for over the years. So they've basically, if you ask me, adopted two mechanisms in that direction. One mechanism is on creating an enabling structure or enabling processes around supporting these employees. If you look at attrition reasons for many of the employees leaving, some of them are personal in the sense they need to go back and maybe do further education, because that's what the Indian economy and Indian society expects people to do, be well educated and probably have a post-graduation at the barest minimum nowadays. At the other end, you have intrinsic workplace related pressures, which are very high call volume, the equation with the boss and so on and so forth. So what organizations have tried to do is, at one end, they've tried to create, you know, facilities like work and study at the same time programs. They've tried to create a crash for young mothers. They've tried to remove some of the problems of people by providing even transport coming and going from work to make it more conducive for them. On the second pillar, which is extremely important today, is also enabling and giving the employees a voice. Most of the time, what helps us just engage or keep people excited within an organization is for them to just know that there is someone listening to them, as simple as that. Now, you can either do that in the form of an HR BP business partner, HR business partner going onto the floor periodically, meeting up with the people, taking in concerns, or you can even create email handles which someone can write to anonymously if they have a complaint. You can showcase that by creating a posh team. So there are varied approaches which are required. And I think to a large extent, many large organizations have succeeded in doing some very good work in this direction.
Great, great. Thank you so much, Vikas. And before I move to other questions, I'll move over first to Soumya. Soumya, over to your presentations, please. I also request Adinkia to roll their presentations for Soumya. There you go.
So thank you very much again for inviting me on this panel. Vikas has set a very nice space for the entire, and he set a nice tone to the entire thing. I'm not at all a PowerPoint person, because a very good dear friend of mine is always opposing it. So somehow I've learned to be in that direction. However, since we are a very visual people, this is something that I would like to put forth to you. I have had industry experience to varied sectors and segments. I was in education, in communications, and then eventually in e-commerce, and finally now I am in luxury business. So having the whole gamut of the interplays of these five industries that I've worked through, it has also given me an insight into the businesses as well as the asset management that goes on in all these industries. Now, could we have the next slide, please? So taking from what Vikas has already, thrown the light on commitment, core values, etc. What I would rather put forth is something on the business trajectory. When a person walks in your organization, what is the person looking at? The person is looking to satiate primarily two things. One is definitely the pocket, and second is the ambition. Now, if that is not interlocked somewhere, it creates an imbalance in the entire ecosystem and you see an ejection. The second very important aspect is you need to recognize, you need to reward people also on a regular basis. It's not just at the end of the year when you do the PMS that you sit on and you talk and you say, well, hey, well, you did good, or no, you're not doing good. And that is why we are not giving you the kind of, you know, expected rewards and incentives that you were looking for. So this is something which is very critical, which creates a hook to the people with the organization. And lastly, it is the flexibility. The COVID has changed the way that we look at work. I come from a manufacturing industry, and we never ever thought, there was no thought on, you know, whatsoever put in work from anywhere. Forget about work from home. Now I have employees, you know, sitting in Bangalore, in Delhi, you know, we have designers in Hong Kong, and they are contributing very well to this new setup that we've created. The second flexibility is little things. The very base of the family as a structure is changing. You know, when we talk about, you know, the youngsters, the Gen Z or the millennials who eventually are getting married today, they are no longer confining themselves to the norm of the couple and the marriage institution. For them, it could be just a living, you know, for them, it could be very different ways. Parenthood is changing, you know. People consciously are taking steps and decisions as to not to have their own babies. Instead, they're satiating their nurturing through adopting pets. So now we have changed the way we are looking at, you know, the family structures as well. Coming from a jewelry background, as is, you know, retaining of talent is absolutely critical, because this industry works in trust. If you don't have trust, the industry ejects the person out like that. So what we actually do is that, yes, we do a very strong background verification, but as well as we create these little, I would call them tentacles or hook-on points, wherein people actually get latched on to, and they create this, you know, longevity with the organization, because jewelry itself is a business which is very complicated. You can't have someone come here and give just 1.5 year and jump out, because that is the amount of time you just know to take just to learn the whole, you know, game of the jewelry business. So this is where we are at this moment, and I wouldn't want to take any further time on this. And with this, I close my presentation and my opening statement. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you so much, Soumya, for setting the tone once again. I think it's really interesting, considering, you know, it's like two ends of the spectrum. Vikas is an industry where the attrition rate, you know, it's so fickle. Soumya, again, is in an industry where, of course, trust is probably the most important factor. And I think probably employee retention ratio there must be also pretty high, isn't it?
Yeah.
The first question to both of you, what are some of the factors that both of you need to take into consideration to ensure that a particular employee, when he or she is being onboarded, stays in that organization for a considerable period of time? I'll start with Soumya and then move over to Vikas.
I'm sorry, I just lost your question. Could you come again?
Okay, I was asking, you know, that how do you find the right talent that stays, or what are the factors that, as an employee or as an employer, that you need to take into consideration to ensure that the employee who's been onboarded sticks to the organization for a considerable period of time?
See, before we onboard people, we actually look into the attitude. And this is not something that I'm saying, you know, just because attitude is a fancy word, not at all. But what I'm saying is that we actually look into people who are really committed and who really want to make a mark in the industry. Just to give you the story, you know, the five of us who walked in the jewelry industry in 2004, we were actually bought in because De Beers put in a lot of pressure on the jewelry industry that they want professionalism to come, you know, into the industry. Now, when the big daddies give that kind of a push, the entire industry's perspective changes. The same thing is happening now when we are now taking that those same thought lines ahead. And what we are doing is that when we and I go to B-schools, fortunately for us, this is the first time that we have, you know, we will be onboarding people from IIMs. So when I'm going there, I'm really looking out for people who are actually committed to the cause that, yes, they want to, you know, give a facelift to the industry. They really want to contribute to the industry in a way that somewhere the industry finds its foothold, its footage. And then I also look into what is their need. You know, I have seen it is paisa, power, you know, these are the two main driving factors. And the third thing is position. All right. If I give all these three in the right mix to the right candidate, and believe there's not a single size doesn't fit all. You have to tailor make things and adjustments and create that cohesiveness and bond with the organization and the candidate so that the candidate stays in. If I don't give them a career trajectory, if I don't let them know as to where the business is headed and where we are planning to take them, you know, through in this journey, I don't think so anyone would want to stay. So we are very open in our communication. We communicate to them on the day that we are offering them the job, that this is how we plan. If you agree, please come on board.
Are you expecting these people whom you are taking, absorbing from the IIMs, to actually stay put in the jewelry industry for the foreseeable future?
I am not expecting anything from them. The only thing that I am expecting is the output for the only amount of time, and if they can bring in the thought change we need. You know, I was just talking to someone that the technology shifts created the Himalayas and the continents. So sometimes you need the shakeups to happen. When people come from outside of the industry who know nothing, they also create very, very vibrant thoughts in the organization. They create a disruption in a way which is a very welcome change. So I'm looking at disruptions. I'm looking at them coming and contributing in a way which is not run-of-the-mill jewelry kind, but they bring in new ways, newness to the entire thing. So yes, that is what.
Which are some of those points? Which are some of the, sorry to interrupt, but which are some of those points or areas in the industry where you're expecting these students or these people to make disruptions?
A is the image. The first thing is the image of the industry. If you've seen a whole lot of gotalas have happened in all the possible industry, but when it comes to jewelry, it's only the two names that pop up. Why? Okay. The second is that because, you know, even today, when I walked in this industry, my mother was like, "Sunar ke saath baithe thak thak kya karegi?" You know, why so much that you're working in this industry? But I knew that, you know, there has to be the voice of the industry. Someone needs to create that and be that voice. So that's one. Second is when these students walk in and when they come with us on this journey, they're also somehow creating a brand, employer, a branding for us. We definitely will have, you know, others also pursuing a jewelry industry as another lucrative career option. This industry pays well. This industry supports you well. Believe you me, even during, you know, these COVID times, you know, we didn't have retrenchment the way we were expecting. Business is back, you know, and we are doing, I was just talking to Vikas about it, we're doing absolutely wonderful in exports. So I'm not seeing anything which should not be, you know, in the favor of people who want to buy. But again, you know, they would love to go and work for a Swiggy and a Zomato for a 21,000 rather than coming to a jewelry industry which even pays them, you know, close to 30 to 40 grand. So there's a perception that needs to be changed. And that is the whole thing that, you know, we're looking for.
I get that. Great. Thank you. Thank you so much, Swami. I'll move over to Vikas. Same set of questions. What are some of those factors that you need to keep in mind?
Sure, Avik. And I think before I answer that, I can't help but share that I'm relating so closely to what Dr. Swamya is saying. It's unbelievable. And it would be surprising, but at the end of the day, when you look at the BPO sector or the ITS sector, it's what I call personally the largest organized sector which no one wants to join. And it's part of the ITS bucket, $200 billion contribution to the GDP last year. And unfortunately, I don't think I've ever come across, even at campus, someone who's raised his hands up and said that, hey, this is the sector I want to really join as my first choice. Mm-hmm. So I can totally empathize with what she's saying. And again, in agreement with her, in the sense that trust is really the core why employees stay. And while you can attract employees with a fancy title or a package or a so-called brand value, there is much more that actually makes them stay, in my experience. And those are a whole set of diverse points ranging from the culture of the organization, the boss that individual has managed to inherit, the learning opportunities that are available, the support that is available within the peer group, and so on and so forth. So an N number of parameters, really, that's what, of course, makes all humans different. But eventually, companies have to realize that today the mind shift is shifting to the point where work is considered one part of your holistic being. Unlike maybe 10, 15 years ago, where the norm was, to just slog it out and, do everything possible. Today, individuals, and maybe rightly so, recognize the fact that they have a personal life, they have a life to give towards society, apart from what they're doing in their offices. So organizations need to be cognizant of that and need to devise their thought process and their enablers, keeping that in mind in my thoughts on this particular.
How do BPOs that sort of fit into this these criteria, maintaining a professional and a personal life? Because long hours, very, very common things now. For the last two decades, we all know how a life in these BPO sectors are, you toil for long nights, eventually you sort of get burnt out, you leave the industry, you move, either take up higher studies or you move to some other industry. But I just wanted to know, is the attrition amongst junior employees or mid-level employees, probably about 40-odd%, is it less for employees who are joining at a much, much senior level, maybe the lateral hires?
Oh, yes, Avik, you're bang on. So the 40-45% is more at the entry level, the folks who've just joined in or at the 1 year, 2 year experience framework. The number does drop significantly at the mid and senior levels for sure. There's no doubt about it. So what organizations really try to address the points that I was talking about is through various initiatives or programs that they run. So like I shared earlier, there could be a earn while you study program where it actually incentivizes employees to enroll in an academic program, which brings in an element of getting locked into the organization while you are completing that degree course. So it's almost like 2.5-3 years you've bought the employees association. Apart from that, organizations are also looking at and doing a very active work in the social sector at a corporate level, where they encourage employees to chip in. And it's not expected for them to do it in their out-of-office hours. One can volunteer to do it within limits within their office hours. So they also feel that they're not getting penalized or not being expected to go beyond their so-called call of duty. And So these are the lateral thoughts and lateral initiatives being run, which are kind of helping, address the requirements or the minds of the new workforce.
Just to understand, let's see, if you were to hire 100 employees at the entry level,
sure.
Typically, what percentage of them would actually stick in the organization after 5 years to rise the ranks?
So I'll in fact throw in some more data points just to make it a little more interesting and valuable for the audience. To hire those 10 in the best of organizations, you would actually go through at least 1,000 CV screenings. But that's the selection ratio. And then you've got multiple tests through the middle, which are in the range, which range from, it could be voice test, it could be technical capability, it could be domain test. Then you've got at least one or two levels of personal interviews. So just imagine the pain required or the effort required to go through so many candidate evaluations to reach those 10 people. Out of them, chances are about 4 to 5, like I said, the 40% figure will attrite within the first 1 year. About two or three will carry on, about the balance 5 will of course carry on beyond 1 year. But about one or two out of them will actually make it to a significant middle or senior level.
Okay, okay. Yeah. What positions do they usually attain? Because let's say, if you stick into that organization for 8 years, what is it that can they expect in both in terms of, in their positions as well as the remuneration?
Correct. So in today's times, Avik, that a person could in 8 years reach a manager, senior manager level. That's not unheard of. But I would also want to bring in the context that this industry is also very young. 1990s, it kind of was germinated. In the 2000s, it actually really took off in a big way. And there are, of course, a lot of iconic people who started off on the shop floor taking calls or even in the admin team supporting the people taking calls and reached levels of senior vice president in that as short periods or as 10 to 12 years. Because obviously there was no trained talent, they were keen, they took the mantle like Dr. Samir pointed out to enter an industry at the right time, grow with it. And what can be better than actually doing that? Of course, now the situation is much more complicated with a lot more players, a lot more competing industries. So the same pool is easily grabbed by e-commerce, by the food startups like Swiggy, Zomato that Swamya also mentioned. So of course, these are difficult times. But I think in 8 years, someone could definitely reach a manager, if not a senior manager position.
Got it. Great. Next question, I just wanted to understand, what are the new strategies for motivating the employees to stay put? The question is both for Swamya, Vikas. Swamya, you can take the first call and then I'll move over to Vikas.
See, the whole way to look at an employee has changed. You have to start looking at them very differently. For example, I'll just take an example of the maternity benefit clause. All right. Now, in maternity benefit clause, it was earlier just, a female getting pregnant, and then now the ways have changed. There is surrogacy in place. Like I mentioned earlier, the whole idea of parenting is changing. The whole idea of couples is changing. There is a whole lot of diversity that has come into play. So when you have all these things and you still hold on to the archaic kind of, the laws, then you never ever create that bond with the new generation. The second thing that is happening is that you have to create a whole line of balance between the employees who are in the age band of say 50 plus and the employees who are just 25. For us, even at the owner's level, we have 4 generations working with us together in this entire, in our company, in the organization. So when you have those kind of, there's a conflict already that is, that is seeping in the system. So there has to be something which balances out, which eases out such conflicts. So for doing that, we have to create a whole balance of both the, both the spectrums, if I can call so, or the age bands. So that balancing is very important, and that is what we do. The third thing is, how are you looking at employees? So, you know, in these times, forget about government making it a mandate that everyone should have an insurance policy. But are you being fair to your employees? Are you getting them registered in their ESIC, et cetera, schemes when it comes to, you know, various, but this is not being done by many organizations, by many companies. Consciously, unconsciously, right, wrong, I will not get into those kind of debates, but it is not being done. So what we have done actually is that not only do we have people covered in ESIC schemes, but we also have the group Mediclaim policy. And when, you know, earlier there was a whole lot of resistance, you know, from the trade unions, from various returns, that why are we getting to this? We are already registered here. But now in these COVID times, we are realizing that it was for their own good. So you have to start, you know, thinking ahead of the time in your own little ways, in the way that your industry can progress. It may not be a revolutionary thought process for the outside world, but it certainly is for your industry. So you have to start looking inside, inward first, create those steps. And that is where, you know, of course, you know, the retention happens. The third thing that we are looking at is that we are now moving, the whole definition of employees is not just the people who are on our payroll, but even their families. So we are reaching out to their families in more ways than one. We are sponsoring education. We are sponsoring, you know, a lot of, you know, things for their families. We are also doing a lot of reaching out, hand-holding in case of career counseling for their kids. When we're doing all this, you know, then the second generation from their family is already hooked on. They already know what our organization and industry is, and they want to willingly walk in. So just small steps. You don't have to take, you know, you don't have to, you know, absolutely change this system, but little doable things which really create an impact, I think that's the way to go.
Interesting point, Swami. I think looking at employees differently, I think that that can really make a world of difference, isn't it? Vikas, your thoughts, please.
Sure. Avik, I'll probably just add a bit to what Dr. Swami has already contributed. Very interesting thoughts. And what I see happening is at two levels when it comes to motivating employees. The first is that this is the era of mass customization. So you can't have broad-based policies and frameworks when you expect everyone to feel excited about them anymore. That's the reality. So you've got to get down to the level of each individual employee. And the bigger your organization is, obviously the bigger the challenge it is for the people driving that connect. The second is the entire management of the employee experience bit. Keep in mind that today, when it comes to our personal lives, our experiences are just so amazing. And this transformation has happened thanks to technology in the last 2 years. You want to book a cab, you can open Uber and click off a few buttons, and 15 minutes, the guy calls you from downstairs. You want to order a burger, you can pick up Zomato, place that order. You can literally see that burger being cooked by the chef. The scooter guy is standing there. He's picked it up. He's on his way. When he's reaching the building gates downstairs, you know it's home. But the same employee comes into the workplace, and then he has to struggle to raise a travel request or to claim a reimbursement. And that just kills it for everyone.
Yes.
Because the difference is just very stark today. You reverse that to 10, 15 years ago, and it was the opposite. I mean, we enjoyed going to our offices because we got some amazing laptops. We had some cutting-edge software. At home, we were dealing with CRT screen and, you know, pretty the Nokia 3310 and so on. So, but today the situation has reversed. And then you have to ensure that that same employee feels that much more engaged about working in the office and delivering for you and getting kicked about going that extra mile. Because today it's also not just enough to do what we call your KRA, right? I mean, everyone expects everyone to just exceed expectations. And when you have to do that, and you want employees to do that, you've got to make sure that you provide them the tools, the processes, the support to make it happen. So that's my
follow-up question here. I mean, now coming to the employee side, you know, what are some of the benefits that employees would be looking at to or expected from the employers to actually stay on in an organization, apart from the rising through the rising ladders, you know, getting the fatter paychecks, What are some of the other incentives that would motivate them to stick to an organization?
I think the number one incentive nowadays for any employee really is flexibility in terms of how he or she is interacted with and is allowed to perform. No longer are, you know, those box approaches going to work. No longer do they want to be regimented and driven and monitored with a webcam over the head. They want to be empowered and they want to be trusted. And the more you do that, my personal experience has been that they are more motivated to give back and to then live up to those expectations.
Correct.
So that's the easiest and most tangible way of giving the power into their hands, but at the same time ensuring that there is some element of guidance, accountability stitched in the right amounts.
Mm-hmm. Soumya, your thoughts on this?
So I would go with what Vikas is saying, but again, it's all about freedom. Freedom to express. You know, gone are the days where there was this heavy hierarchy. You know, today a junior can come up and say, you know, boss, I think this is not right, and you should be ready to accept that. You know, this whole thing about a boss ego has to go, and the leader and the motivator has to come in and set in. So you have to learn to, you know, navigate through these small little points. Boss is defunct, is non-existent. It is the guide and the motivator that exists. And probably a more experienced person who has gone through the other levels can now do the hand-holding and guide you through the process. So freedom is very important. Freedom of thought, speech, everything. You know, and definitely expressing yourself in the right way. But of course, you can't have an anarchy in an organization. Otherwise, the whole thing towards reaching towards a common goal will get lost. So it has to be monitored in a way that people don't feel claustrophobic in an environment. So that is something that you need and that we need to bring in, which we are doing it.
Okay. Any tips, both of you, to hire the right assets for an organization? Maybe, you know, top three.
Attitude, sure. For me, yeah. Attitude is one thing, you know, which is, I never look at the percentage, the colleges, etc., because that could be incidental, accidental, and yes, through a lot of efforts also people get into all these, big B schools. But I definitely am looking in for that attitude, definitely. The second thing that when we look in for is the commitment that a person is willing to give, not only to the organization, but to himself and herself. You know, how much are you willing to, you know, not first, but to give first? So that is very important for us. And the third thing is the person moldable? Is there a learnability quality in the person? Is the person willing to explore? If it is not there, if learnability is not there, then, the person will, I don't think so, be able to contribute to the way that we would expect, and also the person will become rather a sore spot in the organization.
I think the third point is extremely important in the current scenario, isn't it? The flexibility to learn, unlearn, and then relearn.
Absolutely.
Vikas, your view?
Yeah, so I think the world of recruitment hiring has to fundamentally change if we are to enter 2021 on a very productive note. I'll tell you why. In the world of startups, there is a very common terminology used, product market fit. And in the world of sourcing also, in the world of HR, there is something called a candidate and job role fit. Unfortunately, I think in a lot of the cases, and I'm possibly guilty of it myself, I'll take ownership, that we've missed out on that understanding of candidate job role fit or evaluating it very carefully at the hiring stage. What has happened of late, maybe due to business pressures really, is that there is a lot of focus on speed and agility. So hiring teams go with a target closure date in their trackers the moment a hiring requisition is raised. Now, while I understand that there has to be a timeline for recruitment and it cannot be endless, often what ends up happening is that in the aim of meeting those timelines, one ends up sacrificing the quality angle of it to find that right fit that you are talking about. So Avik, my guidance, my tip, number one tip is really to balance that speed and quality very carefully. And the right way to do that is, again, point two, which is get into the job role or designing the job role more carefully than ever before. You know, historically, what has ended up happening is that if we've created a JD once, I can bet my last dollar that gets replicated for every other function or every other level in the company with a little bit of tweaking here and there.
Yes.
The classic things which we learn in a business school, in HR, in terms of doing a job role analysis, time and motion study, none of that is being done in the real world. And let's be honest about it. So if you want to really hire right, you've got to do this. And third, I feel, is also a tip which I would give the HR fraternity is go the extra mile. They make that effort. In the case of a young fresher, it could be, talking to his or her parents to motivate them or to give them confidence in your organization. We've done that in our days in the IT hiring space in campuses, right? In the case of a senior leader who you're hiring, what is the biggest number one concern most often if you're asking them to relocate? Where will my kids get education? Which school will take them in the class 7 or class 8? If you can go that extra mile and give them the confidence that we'll be with you, we'll help you connect to this excellent school, which is well reputed, your chances of locking in that senior leader will increase tenfold.
Yeah, correct. Absolutely. Great points. Let's, thank you. Thank you, Vikas. Let's move to some questions from the audience. Quite a few have actually flown in. The first one is from Kumari R. She asks that, what is the use of advanced analytics and data points in gaining total control on a remote employee's productivity, involvement, and progress? Vikas, you want to take that?
Sure, Avik. Interesting question and brilliantly asked in the session, because I think it's something that all business and HR teams are actually debating currently. We have to again understand that the employees have changed and the shift is tectonic, like Dr. Swamya said. But what we are trying to do is that we are trying to use a methodology from the old world, which is checking whether an employee has done 9 hours in the office, swiped in or swiped out, and trying to just move it to the digital platform and say whether he or she logged into the laptop for 9 to 10 hours, did the number of transactions and so on and so forth. Unfortunately, that's not going to work to an organization's benefit, in my view. You've got to give people the distance. You've got to trust them at this stage. They're also going through a very personal, challenging time. It's not easy the way we are all operating. And you've got to kind of goal them on the output. So forget about, monitoring the hours, transactions, seeing the data points from that angle, but look at it more from the point of view of has the performance at least met, if not exceeded, the previous delivery while they were in the closed office space? Are they equally engaged, or are they more in, or they need more support from your end to kind of keep them mentally fit at this point of time? Those are some of the questions that HR folks should actually ask. Data analytics will be there. You can get 2,000 data points, but just using that data for the sake of further surveillance on your employees is not going to be well appreciated. I can honestly share that.
Great. Next question is for Soumya. Ashok Chopra asks that, how can you provide the right exposure to tools and techniques to help managers adapt to the new world order?
Yeah, just tell them either you perform or perish. Either you are with the flow or you all perish. That's one thing that has really worked, because there's a whole lot of resistance in certain industry towards the change, and change is the only constant. Though it may sound very cliched, but that's how it is. So what we did was that, like I said, we come from manufacturing back to jewelry. So in this kind of a space, and also what Vikas was saying, that when we are talking about measurements of performances, There is something that we have seen, and what we've done is that repetitive performance or the repetitive tasks, you go on the time scale one. And the ones which require a lot of intellect and knowledge, we go on the measurement of the output in the sense of what the new ways of doing things has been designed and given by. Now, coming back to the person's question as to how you would bring people or how you would onboard people to this kind of the new way of thinking is, again, by the use of technology. Everyone has this beautiful device, but we just use it simply to make calls, WhatsApp, but we can use it much more. So what we need to train people to completely explore options that are currently available with them. Tell them that this is what, you know, is going to be the new ways of doing things. And third is definitely link some amount of incentive as a learning incentive to these so that they come and they feel that if they have learned something, it also has tangible benefits to them. So that would be my way of doing it.
Okay. Great suggestion, Soumya. The next question, both of you, Ketki Bhatti asks that what are the types of training and development do both of you, you know, look into and feel is important in the current times, and what forms of rewards and recognition do you provide to your employees? Vikas, you can start and then I'll move over to ask Soumya to take it over from there.
Sure. So Ketki, when it comes to learning and development initiatives, what you really need to keep in mind is that it's obviously got to be very specialized to the kind of industry or the work requirement of your organization is. But beyond that, what I today continue to feel very strongly about is that your digital skills of employees are today going to be hygiene skills, if not already. So are they savvy in using a technology which is helpful or going to drive your business in the coming period? Are they active on social? Are they adding to the brand value of your organization in, you know, online forums and so on and so forth? Those are some of the things that you should definitely take steps towards. Also, you have today again in the market a number of learning experience platforms where with the integration of your HRIS, they can actually determine the learning needs of your employees and suggest the appropriate programs down to the last detail. So those are some points you can consider. When it comes to the second part of your question, in terms of if you can just repeat that, Avik, that last bit.
Yes, I'll just repeat. She asks that, how do you engage and involve? So she was asking that what forms of reward and recognition do you provide to your employees?
So like Soumya said earlier, I think reward and recognition has to be an ongoing process, which is what we also follow, where it's not just a year-end shock or a year-end surprise that is attracted nowadays. In today's world, even a simple call out on a Facebook page or the corporate page of our company it gives a thrill to an employee. We also have the added advantage in today's times to be able to give them e-vouchers of major shopping sites. And these are not high intensive costs required, right, for these. So those are some small measures which we take. The celebrations is the biggest kicker in my view. More than anything, I think recognition and celebrating success, both at the workplace and also some personal achievement. Someone's child has done well in the boards. Someone's just been blessed with a baby. Those are the things you need to keep an eye out for and, you know, celebrate. Keep in mind, however, one simple guidance is that don't overdo these social platforms, because I know we've also had in some ways an overdose of these. So pick up the phone, talk to them sometimes, just hear them out. I think that will be more rewarding for them than anything at this point, at least.
Correct. Soumya, your thoughts?
So a very famous dialogue from Sholay, hai na? Dam jo tum bolo, kaam jo main bolo. You know, that's how this thing was has evolved, the rewards and recognition. But however, it need not always be tangible. Sometimes just a hug and a pat on the shoulder also creates a great amount of value. Yes, social distancing, COVID time, but a virtual hug and a virtual pat can do. Second is that how much are you projecting your employees? So something like a little, a wall of fame kind of a thing created on the wall also does wonders. It creates that whole, yes, we've done something, a little hat, you know, something like performer of the month, something like that, but on a regular basis so that they start looking forward to it. What also it does at the background is that it creates a collective data about the employee and their performance. So at the year end, you're not scrambling through, you know, those data sheets and trying to find out what has the person done and whether the person really deserves to be, the employer of the year. So these are the small things that you need to do on a regular basis so that you're always on top of the game. And it becomes, and remember, fair play. Fair play is very important when it comes to rewards and recognition. So ensure that when you are in HR, you drive the fair play very strongly in the DNA of the organization. If that is not done, then this entire thing about rewards, recognition stands challenged and is a collapsing thing again for the organization. So that's what my thoughts would be on.
Great. Keetki has another question, and she asks that how's the employee performance measures and how do you engage and involve employees so that they're retained? I think the second has been greatly touched upon, but maybe the first part of it. How is the employee performance measured?
I think this also, Vikas has already responded. Yes. Why don't you go ahead?
Sure. See, again, a very broad question, to be honest, Ketaki, but performance measurement, if you go back to the roots, is about really defining the job, the goals, the objectives, drilling them down to the last detail, converting them into metrics, and then measuring against those metrics, right? This is the theoretical format. Where I think as practitioners, we fail most of the time is that the environment is so dynamic that job roles change, the goals change, but somehow the goal sheet which is in the system doesn't change or doesn't get updated. And that's, I think, the pitfall of the entire performance management process. You've got to make sure, invest the time, effort to update those jobs, those objectives, the goals, take the employees' buy-in, agreement on those, and then track them, because these need to be more objective. The more objective you make them, the more accurate your performance measurement system will be. So try and do that.
Got it. I don't think there are any more questions from the audience at this stage. I have one or two before I wrap this up, Vikas and Soumya. Any trends in skillful hiring post the pandemic? What do both of you think on this? What are some of the new trends that are likely to emerge in terms of recruitment?
Fluidity is one thing, fluidity in terms of skill set. Gone are the days of specialists, because you're working as an individual, so you need to have a bit of IT knowledge, including the hardware. You need to know, a bit of data analytics with you. You are your own HR. You are your own business driver as well. So, a little bit of everything should be known to the person. So I think that is what generalist profiles I'm seeing are going to make a huge comeback in these times, is what I'm seeing, more than the specialists. And second is that definitely agility in the way that you think, perform, and again, learning and unlearning is the third parameter. So new skills that people have picked up during, if I can call this, the hibernation period for the businesses.
Vikas, what do you think?
Yeah, Avik, so Dr. Soumya has captured the candidate side. I'll just talk about the organization side.
Sure.
The trends that clearly are visible, and I think they've gone through the roof, is the entire selection hiring process being automated. So whether that's the interviews, whether that's assessments, companies have been actually forced to get onto the bandwagon. And now that they've tried it, even the most, the larger, the mid-size and smaller organizations, they all unanimously feel that this is a very ideal way to go forward. It's got its huge benefits in terms of being more efficient. You end up saving time. It's more convenient for both parties involved. And of course, the measurement, the results are very real time. The assessment sheets are filled in. They're accurate. Decisions can be quicker and so on. So this is something, not only a trend, but I think it's going to be a very lasting practice as we go along, which is the whole automation and recruitment.
Okay. One final question, Vikas, and this is especially for you, considering the BPO background that you have. How do you maintain company culture with so much of attrition?
Brilliant question, Avik, and I think what we've done over the years to try and build that culture is to make sure that at least whatever amount of population that is staying back with you and has managed to grow, like one of the questions that you earlier asked, to make poster boys or poster girls of them, to try and make them the brand ambassadors, to try and make them share the values down the line and encourage more and more people to adhere to them, to lock on. And that's the reason, I think, to a large extent, that attrition has moved from the crazy days of 100%, which was when I joined the industry way back in 2006. So I think all of those efforts have borne fruit in a lot of ways.
Okay. Got it. Great. Let me see just if there are any other questions from the audience. Don't think so. We more or less passed our hard stops time, but I think really great points that came out today. I mean, I think this is one of the best sessions that I sort of moderated. I mean, really insightful points. Thank you, Soumya. Thank you, Vikas. Really, intrusive points that you really captured upon. I mean, looking into employees differently, very, very important as organizations proceed in a post-pandemic world. I'm always obviously interested to know about, how BPO companies sort of adjust to that high levels of attrition. So there can be, countless questions. But thank you so much. I mean, both of you for actually taking time out to join the session. Hope to meet you again soon and have a great evening. Thank you.
Thank you. Sure. Take care.
Yeah. You too.
Pleasure meeting Bye. You both. Thanks. And thank you so much, Dr. Soumya, Avik. It was a great interaction.
Sure. Thank you so much, guys. Bye.
Thanks, Avik. You were a great moderator. Take care.
Thank you. My pleasure. Bye. Thank you.
Bye. Take care.
Thank you.
Yeah.